and was able to turn the games around.
I don't know what I'm doing with my hands, but...
Yeah.
So, ban on material. We'll see what Snowflake ends up banning. I'm going to go ahead and write it. Map is Cursed Hollow. Wouldn't be surprised if we saw a Stitches ban, just because there are a lot of cheeky little spots you can catch people in with, like, and they might be thinking about it, because Faye... Okay, they did ban Stitches. Okay, not surprised.
And Stitches ban. Tychus is going to be the first pick here from Tuvar.
So Tassadar... Oops,
there we go.
Maybe Tassadar Arthas again.
That's possible. That's possible. I would like to see Tassadar again. I mean... Wait, did you say Tassadar who?
Tassadar Arthas.
Oh, Arthas.
Maybe Tassadar Anubaraka.
I think they just had way too much damage.
Yeah, the Nova pick, it was cute, but maybe that wasn't the best choice for them. Maybe they should have, I don't know. They were, with the Tassadar, okay. As expected. Hmm. When you take Anubarak is like, within like, I think, like within a few weeks, I think people might be thinking Anubarak might be one of the best heroes in games. He's just, he is so hard to deal with.
Yeah.
He's got so many stuns. He's surprisingly tanky when you're good with him. And then those Locusts.
But the question is not whether or not he's a good hero. It's whether or not their composition is going to surround Anubarak's crowd control, right? It's like you can't randomly throw an Anubarak into a team because he can actually get focused down pretty quick if he's not played correctly. If there's not a really strong coordination between the whole entire team. So you have to be really careful about who you pick because... Sometimes an Anubarak can go into the middle of a team fight and everybody's like, oh look, there's a bug in the middle of it, let's squash it, and they squash it, and then it's dead, and that's all you get out of an Anubarak. Sometimes that buys you enough time to actually do stuff and allow Anubarak to survive, and that's what we kind of saw last game, but it's whether or not Snowflake's going to be able to make a lot happen out of that. So they do pick up Arthas Falstad.
Yep.
So Tassadar Anub, Arthas Falstad.
Really solid team so far.
Very tanky, I like it.
Again, though, they're going to have to go with either Mouth or Brightwing.
Yeah.
And they're going to need heals against this Sonya Note. Like, yeah, they're definitely going to need some serious heals. So I don't think you can go Brightwing. I think you have to go Mouth in this situation.
I actually disagree.
They got so much burst with that Sonya Nova combo. Mix in...
That's a lot of burst, and I will agree right there. But Polymorph on Sonya.
I don't think that's that. No, okay, that's not that big of a deal. Polymorphing Sonya, though.
That's not a thing?
I mean, it's a thing. You can polymorph anybody, though.
I mean, if Sonya gets into the back line, I would make sure that she doesn't slam my carries to death. But you might be right.
I think
right.
You lose too much healing, though.
Well, if all your enemies
both,
are dead.
I mean, like, Brightwing's always a solid pick. Like, yeah. I mean, it's not like Brightwing's bad. I just think with Malfurion, you'll want the little bit of extra healing with this composition. Because it is very dive heavy. They went with the Malf last game, though, and it didn't work out so well for them. But the compositions are, like, very different for Tuark, so I don't know. If you go Brightwing, I don't think you go Emerald Wind. I think you have to go Blink. I don't think Emerald Wind is that great versus this team. Like, yeah, the Sonya's annoying, but it's really just the... I guess the Uther, too, but... And they go with the Brightwing. Okay. I haven't seen Keelax's Brightwing in forever. It's been a long time. I'm excited. I haven't actually seen a Brightwing in competitive play in a while now.
There was a Brightwing earlier today. Keelax played it. Keelax played a Brightwing 2 games ago. 3 games ago. So
yeah, these games blur together, man.
So,
I don't know what I'm talking about this time. Confirmed on stream. Zoya just says things. He doesn't think. Haven't seen Brightwing in competitive play.
Yeah. All right. So looks like we are ready to go. Prodigious has to say BRB. He's got to go to the restroom real quick. So we'll get that game underway really quickly.
Who won game one here? Well, in 3 minutes, you'll find out that it was Tuark.
Yeah, Tuark won first game. Now, Zoya.
Yeah.
Let's ask this question.
Which comp do you think is going to... Who's got
the better comp? A horse is not an answer.
That's tough. I don't like the Nova pick on 2-arc. I'm still like in the old mindset of Nova, despite I know how good she is. It's just hard to like. I don't know. The Nova Sonya is just so different from what we're used to seeing in the current meta. But it's the double support though. That Rhaegar Uther is so hard to kill. The longer Nova's in a fight, the more damage she's dealing. So. I guess 2-arc just barely.
I think 2-arc as well. I'm not saying that because I don't want Snowflake to win. I think they've got a really standard composition, but I think 2-arc's composition is just a little bit more diverse and is going to be able to do Cursed Hollow a little bit better. And you know why I say that?
Double support, bruh.
No.
No.
Why am I saying it?
I don't know.
Tychus Rhaegar.
Oh, people, like, Tychus Rhaegar isn't as powerful as it used to be, and people have stopped taking Bloodlust. Like, it's...
Tychus Rhaegar is going to be really good in a very, very closed hallway for tribute
fights. Oh, okay. I thought you meant...
That's what I'm saying.
The Odin Bloodlust thing. Yeah, I can see that too. That's very good. Let's introduce those teams again for the 15th million time today. As the blue team, we have Team Snowflake, Idra on Tassadar, LZ Gamer on Anubarak, Chiltek on Arthas, Keelax on Brightwing, and Faye rounding out the team on Falstaff.
And over here on the right-hand side, it is 2-arc, previously taking the first game against Snowflake, Furious D on Tychus, as well as on the Wonderbilly. Mr. J Pickles playing Sonya, the Barbarian. Quibsy playing Nova. Uther being played by Acedia 2369, and Protege is playing Rhaegar.
So I want to point out something today that's pretty disappointing.
Well, it's pretty disappointing.
We haven't seen a single money pig.
That's true.
Only the good players have money pigs.
I wouldn't agree with that at all.
You're going to bed.
You know why? Arthalon has a money pig. Oh, shots fired. Shots fired.
Chiltek here getting caught off guard by Quibsy. The shot does go down. And Proge is here as well, with Chiltek taking this a bit too greedy. LZ Gamer coming as well. A lot of damage on stat. Nova is coming from behind. The storms do go down. Will they be able to kill Protege? The healing ward was not enough to save him. And what was looking like a gank on Chiltek suddenly turned into a kill for Snowflake.
You know, it's really hard to take down that Lich King, especially with those Death Coils. I mentioned in one of my videos that when I'm playing with Arthas, I love to just save my Death Coils for nothing more than just keeping myself alive in the early game. Sometimes you need a little bit more burst, and it's okay to use that Death Coil, but Death Coil is so good for keeping you alive until you're about level 7. And that is actually really funny that they had that turn around on them. It just goes to show at how quick you can respond to these types of things on the map. Your map awareness allows you to either win or lose a team fight.
Absolutely. We're actually, Idra getting caught a little bit off guard here. We got three people here. There's a lot of stuns there. He wants to save his E though for after both the stuns are used. The body block is pretty hard here. Nice kill there. A thing that Nova's have been doing a lot lately is using that clone to body block, and it's so impactful there. I think they would have gotten the kill either way without that clone body block, but still, good job there. Kills 1-1 right now. Experience is even.
And what's also really nice is during the time that Idra went down, they also grabbed Siege Giants, which is going to be pretty good for that top lane. Keelax, of course, also grabbing those bribe stacks, but while we're talking about all of this and the Siege Giants are pushing down on top lane, the Curse Tribute is coming up.
Yep, and we do have Sonya taking that giant camp, and Mr. J. Pickles is actually pretty low. He might have to back before going for the tribute. They do have the double support, but that's still a lot of heals that will have to be dumped on him as soon as he shows up. We have Falstad and Rhaegar staying bot lane. This allows Faye to just fly up there if it's needed for the team fight here.
And that's a really big disadvantage there for 2-arc, because Falstad can just fly up there, but Rhaegar really can't. So if there is a time where this actually starts turning around on 2-arc, then that means that, or on Snowflake, that means that Rhaegar is going to be really delayed in getting to that fight. And that's going to be a huge disadvantage for them. But Quibsy is doing a really good job of delaying this.
And you have to keep in mind that 2-arc is getting experience from was from three lanes. They were actually getting experience from mid as well. Shieldtek actually getting burst down pretty low here. 50, a little bit out of position though. He's going to get Polymorph and should die here. The heals from Uther are pretty strong. Shieldtek is running for his life. Uther is getting pretty low and he is going to fall as well. Currently a 2 for Zil right now. Shieldtek, will he actually be able to get out of here? Wow, the jukes are real. Mr. J Pickles being caught in the corner. Faya secures a kill as well on Tychus. Mr. J Pickles is going to fall as well. And he does not go. Mr. J Pickles just barely lives. So 3 for nothing. Starting that experience lead, that 2-arc had is gone, and the tribute goes to Snowflake.
And you know, Snowflake is taking really good advantage of the fact that Arthas is their main target, it seems to be, for 2-arc. And using that tanky hero, putting all those shields as well as everything else they possibly can on Arthas, is allowing them to keep everything alive behind Arthas and using him as a buffer. And because of that, that allows their damage heroes to just kind of keep doing damage and not have to worry about repositioning and stop auto-attacking. And that allows them to keep winning that team fight. I mean, that's exactly what happened at the level 1 or level 2 fight in the very early beginning of the game, and it's happened again at this tribute. So whether or not 2-arc's going to change who they start targeting is going to be the big question.
Arflon heard your money pig joke, and he sent you messages on Skype, apparently.
Oh, no.
Oh, man. Level 8 to level 8, waiting for that tribute to spawn.
Guys, I might not be alive after this cast. Tell my wife I said hello. Alright, so we have 2-arc is 3-manning mid, and it looks like they want to try and clean up those knights before they're going to be able to get up to the tribute, but I don't know if this is going to be costing them a little bit too much time.
We do see Idra going for that tribute here at the top lane. Will he be able to get it? A snipe goes down on him. We have Shieldtek trying his hardest to zone here. Idra should be able to actually loot this, and then we do get the second tribute for Snowflake. Both teams have to go back to lane, and with both teams already level 9, we should be seeing a level 10 tribute fight for the third one.
Oh, I forgot the music's not on. I love the music for this map. And yeah, with the thing I want to keep in mind, though, is the fact that the levels are actually still pretty even, and this actually might, as long as Mr. J Pickles doesn't get taken down here, Shieldtek taking a lot of hits, and finally Arthas does go down after focusing him down all game. 2-arc finally got a kill on him. But the thing I want to really mention here is that they're both going to be level 10 for this next tribute fight, so there's not going to be a huge advantage for 2-arc to really get the in this team fight, and if I mean, that's what they really needed, because this is going to be the second of three tributes for Snowflake. And if Snowflake is able to get this last tribute, I mean, that's a lot of map domination that they're going to have.
Level 10 versus level 10. That Rhaegar has been soaking up so much experience in that bottom lane. It's what's keeping, despite the kill difference, that's what's keeping 2-arc ahead of experience, or even at least even on it. And there we go. The tribute is bottom side. We have Giants pushing top for Snowflake again. And we have 4 people from 2-arc here at the Grave Golem. I don't know if this is smart. This is a curse. The Grave Golem pushes well, but it's going to be going against Giants.
Oh, my meta versus meta. Oh, my meta versus meta. So, yeah. So, I guess 2-arc assumed that Snowflake was going to go hard for the tribute. Snowflake said, well, if they think we're going to go hard for the tribute, then we're going to go hard for the Grave Golem. My favor, heroes. And go hard for the hard cam, and if they get that means that they get both the tribute and the Grave Golem, and it was a gamble, but it worked.
It was a good gamble, and you're definitely right, it worked. Grave Golem is pushing top lane for 2-arc, and it might actually get that keep there, so that is helping them out there, but first keep does fall for 2-arc, and Snowflake should be able to rotate mid and take that one as well. Will that top keep actually end up falling? It's so close, but it looks like it will go down. So 1-for-1 right now. That actually worked out decently well for 2-arc. They're going to end up losing a second keep, which is a decent amount of map control. Snowflake might actually just be able to rotate top. No, they don't have enough time for that. Only 20 seconds.
You know, I have to agree with your conclusion there, is it actually did kind of work out pretty well for 2-arc. Getting that 2-for-1, I mean, that's an experience as well as map control that's going to be a little bit unexpected for somebody who just got cursed. So, overall, I completely agree. Getting that Grave Golem ended up actually working out pretty well for them. As long as they can actually survive this top 4 engagement and not lose too much down bot action. No, okay, the Grave Golem was cleaned up, so
we haven't seen a serious team fight in a while, by the way.
That's true.
And, I'm waiting for that. Let me check what heroic. So we did see the blink heal from Keelax, which we predicted would happen. Emerald Wind's not the best versus this team, and they need that extra healing. Everything else is looking pretty normal. We did see Ancestral Healing. We're not seeing that Bloodlust. Yeah, so everything is pretty normal on the heroics end. I do like the fact that we have so many rewinds in this game. Wow, so many rewinds. And Sonya ended up taking Spell Shield.
Acedia now making his way into the middle of the team and does get a Divine Storm as well as a beautiful lead coming out there from Mr. J. Pickles, but I don't know if it's going to be enough. Furious V picking into his Odin, and it's actually going to get a couple of really good Qs, but unfortunately it's not actually enough. A lot of damage coming out here from Snowflake. Just so much survivability coming out here with the Brightwing's Blink Heal as well as everything else. Furious D is barely going to get caught at the last second and get taken out.
You can't fight in a narrow corridor like that, even with an Uther. You would think, oh, Divine Swarm and Precision Strike. No, not against this team. The Archon splash damage is huge in that spot, and it's the perfect lineup for the Shock and Awe. Those two combos, the Archon plus the Shock and Awe, destroyed 2Arth in that team fight.
You know, I was a little bit tentative to say that the composition from Snowflake was worse, but now I'm actually starting to see, I think the Shock and Awe is a little bit better than those Tychus Qs.
You're only saying that because I didn't say it for the first time. Kevin's metagaming me, guys. Tell him to stop.
Can't help it.
Tribute to top lane, guys. Level 15, level 13, no 16 just yet. That's a huge
Snowflake's
advantage.
Snowflake's heroics are all down, though.
Yeah, that's a good point. They're just going to let this one go, which is smart.
Really smart. They still have two more tributes to gather after this one. Snowflake is picking their fights, and they're picking them really well. They get the Siege Giants. That's going to stop 2Arc, because 2Arc's still at a very dominating position as Snowflake waits for the heroics, has to back up because they know they're, you know, that was going to be 2Arc's next move, is go for the Siege Giants. They got the Siege Giants while 2Arc was getting that tribute. Really good prediction of what 2Arc was going to do.
Snowflake really wanted to hit level 16 before this next tribute. Those level 16 talents are pretty important.
Stone Skin on Arthas, awesome.
Yep.
Depending on how he wants to build the Anub Arrak, it could be a big talent for him as well.
That tier there is like almost heroic level in a sense. There's just so many good choices that really just... I mean, Stone Skin alone on Arthas is what? Like, it's 30% HP, right?
That's, yep, 30%
that's
shield
insane.
Of HP.
Here we go. The tribute is being fought for. They are level 16 here. Keelax getting bursted down by the Brightwing. Still alive, though. Shieldtech being chased here. Here comes the Divine Storm. Will it hit enough people? Archon has been popped. Odin is in the back here. The big Rhaegar heal on Arcadia. But this Great Pickles is being focus fired down. Arcadia is trying to go onto Idra. And it's just looking like a huge wipe again in favor of Snowflake. They're just having the stronger team fight here. Arthas has fallen, but it is currently a 1-4-3, and with Nova dying here as well, 1-4-4, Snowflake's team fight is just too strong.
Again, they just keep focusing down Chilliteq, and I think that's the biggest advantage that Snowflake could possibly get without making a conscious decision. I mean, granted, Chilliteq is putting himself in a position where he has to be focused down, but because they're focusing down Chilliteq, it just allows Snowflake to just completely wreck house on everybody that they need to. And that allowed them to grab that Rhaegar first and foremost. Then immediately the Uther after he threw down that Divine Storm. And then finally the Nova at the cleanup. And those are the types of things that you need to make sure that you're rotating appropriately. And at the same time, you're not going to be focusing down the people that are not going to die.
Suddenly, we see Snowflake with two Grave Golems that is... Like, you have to respond to the Grave Golems when you're 2-0. So this just gives full map control. Snowflake can do whatever they want. And they actually got the top port as well. That's just so much map pressure.
It's map pressure. It's going to allow them to grab yet another tribute unless 2-0 really wants to try and force this tribute to be in their favor. Because this is where we're starting to get into that scary spot of two out of three tributes. If you let Snowflake get this tribute, that means your next fight is a guaranteed fight that you have to fight Snowflake. But
if Snowflake gets this tribute fast, I think they can just push bot from with this Grave Golem.
Yeah. But the thing is that if they let... because Snowflake now has this tribute, it's yet another time where Snowflake can decide to be where they want to be, whereas 2R can't have that decision because they have to go and fight for that tribute.
But 2R does have level 16 now. And that's a good point. You know, after that fight, that was a situation where Snowflake didn't have all their heroics up. And that's when they would want to fight. Mm-hmm. We saw Snowflake give up that one one tribute to them because they just couldn't fight without the heroics. And that was that option. So now for another curse, being that tribute mark, they'll have their heroics up. Everything's up. I mean, what do you do? Like, what do you think 2R, like, this outside of comp, what do you think 2R can be doing? I mean, is it just because they're focused on that Arthas? Is that the reason why they're losing these team fights? Or is it just composition?
I mean, it could be composition, positioning, as well as what their targets are. Snowflake, of course, has also been in a really good talent advantage every single time there's a team fight. So it's like almost like a timing attack from StarCraft 2. Where you're forcing these engagements at times when you know you have not only just 5-on-5, but you have a talent advantage as well. And I think 2R just saw everybody trying to party bush there.
Well, here we go. Keelak's getting initiated on here. Chilltech coming up from below. LZ Gamer coming from behind. Everyone's going straight into Keelak here, but LZ Gamer leaps across the map here. Archon has been popped. Nova Precision Strike hits nobody here. Big Uther Sun onto Faye and Keelak. They really want to kill them so bad, but meanwhile, Idra is just destroying Furiously. Uther is going to fall as well. There we go. Finally seeing Tassar and Brightwing get killed here. The Shock and Awe just happened a little bit late. And there we go. That's what we needed to see from 2R. It just appeared to be that they were focused on the wrong turret. Once they decided to actually go ham on that Brightwing and Falstad, they were able to completely change what the team fights have been looking like.
Exactly. The fact that Chilatech is the last one to die definitely shows that they were like, okay, we need to stop focusing down Arthas because that's impossible. It's just not working for us. Even though he's like in our face, he's really making this hurt for us. We need to just avoid him and go straight for the targets that really matter. That's what they did. That's how they're able to clean up that fight. They need to use their damage to their advantage. They don't have the ability to sustain Snowflake's team composition without by slowly taking out their tanks and then going for the normal team fight. They need to go for the things that are keeping the things alive first, and then kill everything else, because they don't have the ability to sustain trying to kill the Arthas while everything else is killing them.
You're absolutely right. And it's still not in here for 2R, though.
No,
not
at all.
Even if they win this next curse, they still have a lot of map to make up for. Well, I mean, I guess they have taken two forks, but...
It's really... The forts are almost paired. It's 4-3. And actually, Snowflake, I would expect to be at a little bit more of an advantage than they are, considering that they've been winning these team fights pretty dominantly. It's 13-7 in the kill count. However, I think 2ARK's been doing a pretty good job. Now, here, Zoya, is where we see some interesting stuff.
Okay, this is like the perfect tribute spawn for 2ARK.
They're already in position, they're a little bit spread up. That's the only thing I have a little bit of a reservation about. But here's where Snowflake has to engage on 2R.
I don't think Snowflake's too far away. They're going to get this curse.
Yeah, they're going to get the curse. And that's going to be where 2R can possibly turn this around. RNG is a little strong on this map, not going to lie.
That was the one spot it could have spawned that would just like completely destroy. So that's something you have to be in count for. You know, we have 2R just going ham on this keep.
I really like this, but this is also really scary. They have to make sure that they're not focusing the keep for too long. Here comes the engagement from Snowflake. Idra going immediately into that Archon. Are they focusing on the right targets? Faye now being leaped on by Mr. J. Pickles, but they have to be really careful because they can't go too close to that core. And Faye is dancing that line perfectly. And that's going to allow Snowflake to start getting some of these kills where people just can't go. And I think that was a little bit too advantageous for Snowflake. For 2R to try and force an advantage that I think they misunderstood what they had.
And then Faye just flying in over here. Should be able to kill Quipsy. No, Quipsy does get away. Arthas and Faye are in hot pursuit. And they do have level 20 now. That should be two resurgence of the storms. We see Keelak taking that storm shield. All to be expected. I mean, that's just...
Let's talk about Faye's positioning in that fight, because that was perfect. She was right on that line between the core and the keep, right? Yep. Where the core can start hitting. And she's like, you know what? If they walk into the core, they're taking additional damage that not even my team has to worry about dealing. It's just additional damage. And that's a major advantage for Snowflake to take advantage of. And they did it perfectly. Faye was just dancing between that line for where she can do damage and where that extra damage starts coming in on people like Mr. J. Pickles. And I think it was beautiful, and that allowed them to turn that fight around. It was just free damage for Snowflake to do. Now, Arthas does get absolutely cleaned up, and oh man, the Grave Golem does reset. But that's going to allow two Arc to get it.
Now, it's something we have to keep in mind that still we have Snowflake one tribute away from that curse, which can suddenly turn things. We've got a few minutes, though. After a curse happens, tributes get, I think, like a 3-minute cooldown or something like that before they can start spawning again. So we still have a few minutes before that can happen, so there's going to be a lot of roaming around the map, taking and clearing up mercs. But if Snowflake can win this next team fight, let's look at how many resurgences they can. They get, I believe, two, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Two Arc, they get Uther and Sonya. So if, I don't know, a cursor would be nice, but we have two Arc pushing top lane. They want to get this keep. They are not happy with that last fight of this keep. They definitely want it now.
Yeah, that's a really weird thing. I actually haven't seen Rhaegar. Actually, I don't remember. Do Rhaegars grab the level 20 ancestral healing?
It
does the splash healing
I
now?
Don't play support, so I don't know.
I think they do. And if they do, I'd like to see how this team's going to survive, because they seem to just have a lot of survivability problems.
No, he took Storm Shield.
He took Storm Shield. Okay. That works too. As long as they can survive a little bit longer against Snowflake, I think is all they need to really do.
That Grave Golem was doing work to that key clock.
Yeah.
It's going to get cleaned up before it kills it, but still. And this allows Snowflake to take the map, allows them to get knights and stuff, and prepare for this tribute. The tribute should be spawning soon. And there it is.
Nice. There it is.
And another perfect RNG position for 2 Arc. They get to get there right away.
Yeah, and Snowflake is going to grab those knights, and the knights are actually not going to do that much. There's still two towers and a gate to go through before anything, so it's not going to be a keep or anything. It's going to be a little bit of, you know, damage on those towers, but 2 Arc did definitely get the better end of that deal. Mr. J. Pickle's getting a little bit engaged upon. Chill attack again. It seems to be the focus of the damage right now. Asadia doing a lot of damage to Idra. Idra gets taken out before the Archon goes down. Here comes an ancestral healing as well as the planetary strike on Chilatek. Chilatek now starting to get away, and it looks like 2 Arc is going to be able to get another tribute.
They're being pushed away pretty hard right now.
Oh, there goes Zeke taken down as well.
Does have resurgence up, so he's a back up immediately. But 44 seconds on Tassadar. Will 2 Arc be able to do anything?
I don't know. They can get their knights, they can get their siege giants, they can clean up these knights. But what are they going to be able to do after that?
It's just one of those awkward points. You know, that's the thing about mines. There's always objectives you can take, but when there's not, you know, it's just waiting for that next tribute. You know, there's no forcing any early fights. There's no, like, this map is so huge that you can't be like, well, let's just go push up this lane and then try and take a keep. No, because by the time you get across the map, the next tribute spot. So it's just, you gotta take the knights and then you just kind of roam around watching Snowflake clean up your knights.
You kind of like float in the middle of the map, I always find. It's always a really great place to be in Cursed Hollow, is that if you're floating in the middle of the map, if it's top, if it's bottom, you're gonna be in position for it pretty quick. And that's exactly what 2 Arc's doing. You saw that they just kind of gravitated straight back to the middle until they found the tribute is going to that location. Now that allows them to get to that in half the time that they would have been if they tried to decide to push top or bottom. And it looks like there's going to be another team fight. Furious a little bit behind. Divine Storm coming out here. Mr. J. Pickles following that up with a really good leap. Is he going to be able to get all the kills? Brightwing does go down. Keelax is out of the game. Mr. J. Pickles doing a lot of damage. Chilatek taking a lot of hits. Is he going to go down? No, he's going to back up in the last second. The healing ward is still up. Quibzy is backing up. Does he get the last snipe on Idra? He does. But now it's Faye versus Quibzy.
Idra did so much damage that fight. That Archon just went full hand. He has the level 20 Archon talent, Twilight Archon, make his damage even harder. He was storming the entire front line. Like, it looked like Turok was about to wipe that team, and then all of a sudden, oh, it looks like Faye does end up, Quincy misses the snipe. So, the thing about Nova this late in the game is she can, any squishy hero can die immediately.
She can 100 to 0 pretty easily. Wow.
Wow. That was such an impressive team fight on both ends, and again, nothing happened. But the return is a lot. What?
Where are we with the tributes? We're at 2. Had a 2-2.
Yeah. Like, with that resurgence, Sonya was able to get over there, and it forced Faye out. Faye couldn't really deal with the Nova, and when knowing that Sonya could be there any second. Sonya is such a scary hero to have resurgence on. Just because, like, her pressure in, like, low team. Like, when it comes to a lot of people, Sonya can die quickly, but when it's like a 1v1 or a 2v2, Sonya is so impactful.
Oh, yeah, incredibly.
And Turok again in the perfect position for these tributes. But most of their heroics are actually up. We're missing Archon in 4 seconds and Anubarak.
Oh, Chill Attack getting focused down pretty hard, but there's a double shield on him, Stone Shield as well as Acid Arc Shield. Divine Storm coming down here. LZ Gamer taking a lot of hits, but he does finally use his E. Acedia now finally going down after using his Divine Storm. And it looks like Anubarak did also get taken out as well. Idra now finally going down, and Chill Attack too!
Oh my god. We have a Anubarak back up, Faye and Keylaps running. We're gonna get another curse here. It is a 4v3 for 50 seconds. Turok is gonna be able to do so much with this curse. Will they be able to actually end? It's going to be tough. They still have that Odin dropping the nuke. Is Turok on the verge of 2-0-ing Snowflake?
Might be. There's the keep. Turok now coming in here. Mr. J Pickles trying to get into that engagement. Yet again, there's that core that I was talking about before, the free damage. They want to avoid it as much as possible. Turok does have to back up a little bit because Mr. J Pickles is really hurt. But they are able to get a pretty good sizable amount of damage on a lot of things. If they can take out this keep, Mr. J Pickles going hard on Faye. Not able to do that much. LZ Gamer getting caught. He's going down.
No resurgence, 10 seconds on Idra. They're targeting the core. They're level 23. It's going to melt so fast. Helix and Faye are doing their best to defend. It's at 85%. A huge heal on Mr. J Pickles. There's the Nova precision strike. Protege is trying his hardest to kill this core. It's at 17% for 20%. Turok's done it. I don't think they can stop this. Turok has 2-0 Snowflake.
Oh my god. I don't believe it. I don't believe it.
Snowflake, highly regarded as the second best team in the world. Glorious. Rounding up the third, Turok, less than a month ago, was considered maybe top 10, barely. Nowhere near the level of these guys. They 2-0 Glorious. They 2-0 Snowflake. What happened to this team, Kev?
They back, honey. That's what happened. They back.